Please welcome Mr. Yannis Behrakis. Yannis Behrakis, who is a Reuters photojournalist, and since 1988 he has covered some of the most important stories of the last three decades all over the world, and he has won the Pulitzer Prize this year with his Reuters team. Yes, let's applaud for him. Good morning, Yannis. Sit.
Good morning.
With good morning. Thank you. We can see. We will start with a photo. This is one of the most famous photos of Yannis that has been in the front page of the New York Times some months ago. A photo that is tragic in its beauty, I think. What's the story of this photo? What do we see exactly, Yannis?
I think it's on the 11th or 12th of August, 1915. It's I'm on the coast of Kos, one of the islands where refugees used to come, and migrants. And it's early in the morning. It's a beautiful, typical summer morning in Greece. And this raft is coming from Turkey. It runs out of petrol or something. So I call the Coast Guard to come and help. It's something we did, the journalist. And it's drifting. And I took some pictures with a long lens, and it was a good feeling because the weather was good and they didn't seem that they are in immediate danger. And finally, the Coast Guard came, helped them. They came out, and you know, we were doing high fives and selfies on the beach. So it was a tragic moment, but with a beautiful outcome.
Are these two notions compatible? Tragedy.
Yeah,
and beauty?
You know, Spinoza said that hope and fear come together, and I've seen this, and I photographed this. For many years, because I'm doing refugees, and refugees is one of the most important, excuse my expression, products of war. This is one of my main things, and I've been dealing with refugees. I have refugee blood. My grandmother came actually from Turkey. She was an ethnic Greek that came in 1922, and she was helped by the French Navy. So, you know, I have a refugee blood, and I feel for them. And for me, it's easier. And in this case, it became a personal project, in a sense that these people were coming to my country. So I was, you know, a bit, are we going to be good enough for them? Are we going to be in front of the international community? Are we going to be nice people? Are we gonna? So it was, you know, a bit different. Sorry, I get carried away.
You get too personal.
Yeah.
Let's see a series of photos, the arrival photos, and I would like to ask you a question about the moment. How do you choose the moment, and how do you manage to capture the moment? For example, this photo here. How do you choose your theme?
And well, you know, photography is a combination of situations where you want to have the perfect light, or you want to make the light your work for you, and then to align the decisive moment, as the master Cartier-Bresson used to say, with, you know, a photograph that makes people think, creates feelings. So, for example, in this photograph, this hand can be my hand, your hand, everybody's hand, the hand of the world. And for me, it was important to show, apart from the drama of the refugees, the response from the people on the other, on the other side. So this hand, actually, this hand belongs to a garbage collector. It's not an NGO, it's just a simple man who is going around collecting garbage for the Lesbos municipality.
Island.
And he's there and he's helping people as well. So it's a great moment for humanity. It's a beautiful moment.
Let's see the previous picture. This one also, of course.
We can see whatever you want, just tell me.
Tell this picture. I mean, it's very, on a symbolical level, it's very important because this man, he's on the air. He's not in his own country anymore. He's not into the sea. He's not in the other country. How do you...
Yeah, well, thank you for introducing the picture this way. Actually, these people are refugees from Afghanistan. And you know, Afghanistan is a landlocked country. They don't have sea. So for some of these people, it was the first time they saw sea, this blue thing. They've seen it in the movies or something, and now they can feel it. And they can. Some of them said, oh, it's salty. It's amazing to witness this kind of situations. Anyway, so they arrived, and this guy is, you know, he's jumping, he's leaping from, you know, his prison to freedom, to Europe, to civilization, to hopefully a friendly place where he has a better future. You know, if you look at the faces of each of these people, you can see fear and hope, what I said before about, you know, what Spinoza said. On the left side of the picture, you can see this guy with the yellow and red, who is one of the Spanish NGO who is helping. You know, I mean, it's like a leap to the future, to the hope, to a better tomorrow. Yeah.
You just talked about help. Have you faced the dilemma, do I take a picture or do I help?
Well, by taking pictures, I help. This is how I feel, and this is, you know, my motivation and inspiration. But, you know, obviously, there have been situations where I put the camera down, as most of my colleagues did. but I don't think it's a matter of discussion or taking a selfie, look at me helping. My mother said, when you do something good, keep it for you and your family. Don't make a big deal. But also, it can be an example for the others. So you have to keep a balance, and I'm very cautious with this. I feel embarrassed to say that I help. Obviously, you know, you help, but the idea is, I tell you what, I remember, and this is very important, when I was on the coast of these Greek islands or up north, and I remember on the coast especially, because I've been covering this right from the beginning. I remember these people coming out from the boats, and they would come to me. The first thing they would do is they throw their wet life jackets. And then a lot of them would come in and hug me. So I became their life jacket on shore. And a lot of them would say, please tell our story. We need you. We need you to tell our stories. And it's something I've witnessed, you know, over the years where, you know, that's the epitome of journalism. You know, we are there to tell their story. We are the eyes of the global audience. So this is what I wanted to do, and to become your eyes and become their voices. And I guess I did it well.
Yes, but as a photojournalist, so. You're into the action, in the action. So do you have to choose sometimes? I mean, the ethics of a photojournalist can be against the ethics of a human being, of a simple human being?
Yes. Well, look, I mean, I work for Reuters, and in Reuters every year we've been reminded of the basic ethics of journalism, and it's very important. And, but, you know, I also have my ethics. So usually they come together. They're close. But if the moment comes, I choose my ethics. The ethics I was taught by my family and the, you know, the philosophers I read and life and all this. But as I said before, you know, there are situations where a boat arrives for example, the picture we saw earlier with all these Afghans swimming.
Let's see it again, yes.
Yeah, it's like a couple of pictures before, where they jump off the off the boat, and they swim. A lot of us through that one. A lot of us through life jackets, and actually one of us went in the sea to help them. A lot of them, obviously, they don't know how to swim. So if, you know, you can judge, this is how I do it, by instinct and by, you know, acknowledging the situation. So if I feel that it's important for me to grab somebody, to be that hand, I do it without second thought. And more or less, I think most of us do it. But you know, if I am next to 10 NGOs who are there to help and, you know, lifeguards and stuff, I will take pictures of the lifeguards helping the refugees, because there are two issues here. One is the plea of the refugees coming. The second one is I want to show that they are, the humanity is alive and these people are there to help. Did I answer your question?
Yes, yes, of course, okay. You asked. You answered. I would like to ask you, what was the moment, or choose one moment of all these moments that you have lived with these refugees that moved you deeply?
Okay, well, obviously a lot of moments, and a lot of sad moments, and a lot of hopeful moments, but I... I would choose, it's easy for me, I was asked this question before. It's about one picture, maybe we can find it. It's a picture of an old lady. It's not a fancy picture. It's not a picture that you go, wow.
Let's see the picture, the last picture.
So, yeah, okay. So it's in Kos again, and I think it's August. And a lot of, it's very early in the morning, and a lot of refugees are coming on boats, and things are going well. There is no drama. The boats are arriving. A lot of people are waiting for the boats, and they help them. They give them water and everything. So it's a nice morning. You know, I take some pictures, and... actually, it's the same morning as the morning of the first picture with a big sun. And at some point, I realized this lady is sitting on the beach, and she's very calm, as you can see, and she has this very, very light smile, and the beautiful light is coming, and the light paints her face, and it's a moment. And I'm not taking pictures. I'm looking at her, and I'm like, wow, she's like the Madonna. She's like, yeah, it's, and I don't want to spoil the moment, so I take some pictures slowly, and then I want to talk to her. A lot of times I talk to them for my captions, and I take their names, and I want to tell the story. So I went near her, and most of the photographers and other people, they are on the other side. Taking pictures of the action and the reaction, and that's a very quiet moment. So I go there, and I stood next to her, and I reach out, and I wanted to give her a sweet, which is like a traditional gesture of hospitality in my country. You give them a sweet, welcoming, and that moment, and I said, I know a few words in Arabic, I say Ana Sahafi Yunani, and Marhaba, and she spoke a little bit of English, and then I realized that she's blind. And it's a moment, I just said that, and yeah, I'm full of emotions. And so she grabbed my hand, and I remember it was warm. And it was beautiful, and it filled me up with beautiful emotions. And she took the sweet, and her family was nearby and spoke English. And she said, well, my name is Amun, and she was like 72 years old. And she was a Palestinian refugee that became refugee for the second time. It was a Palestinian refugee living in Syria and then became Palestinian and Syrian refugee. So it was, and it was a story, and, you know, one of these things, and you discover the story. So, you know, we exchanged a few pleasantries. You're welcome here, and I wish you good luck and everything. And she kept holding my hand and had this beautiful smile, and then I can see her family. They were, half of them were crying, half of them were smiling. So it was another amazing, beautiful, I think it was one of my best mornings in the last few years. It was so simple, but so full of meaning. Thank you.
Your photos have really deep strength. I would like to show you the photos, the arrival photos, where it's kind of, it's something like a biblical landscape. No, sorry, the Exodus, the departure photos. So you see all these people walking, leaving, and when I use the word Exodus, is because it has the root ex, the Latin and Greek root that means out. So they're going out of their countries, out of their lives, in fact. And these are, it's like the passion, like this one, let's stay. This is one of the most powerful pictures that I have ever seen. There is a detail, two details. Yannis, which are these details?
These are Iranian migrants and refugees who are they're trying to leave Greece to move north. But at some point, the border was closed for some of the refugees, Iranian and Somali and some more. So these refugees were stranded. And I don't know if you noticed, some of them sewed their lips in protest. And it was, and the guy on the left who is, with his hand, he was a civil engineer, and they were asking me every day, are they going to open the border? Are they going to open the border? And, you know, for me, it's easy to say, yeah, man, have hope. But I don't want to give fake hope. So I knew that the border is not going to open. I mean, from Greece to the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia. I knew that this was over. So I said, look, if you ask me with a hand on my heart, I would say no. Try to find another way out. You know, it was sad because some journalists were saying, yeah, man, sit here. And very few. And I had an argument. I said, no, don't give them fake hopes. Give them, a good information. So anyway, yeah, and I just want to say something. The pictures we saw earlier, they were, as I said, I've been doing refugees and migrants for almost three decades. So the pictures we saw earlier were not actually from Greece. It was
exactly
from Libya. It was from Kosovo and I can't remember, something else.
I would like just make a last comment on this photo. It's like a pietà, you know, when the Christ is off the cross, and it's fabulous. It's like a painting of El Greco.
You like to make me feel a bit uncomfortable.
Yes, that's.
That's his hobby.
And I think
we had this conversation before, and I said I don't want to. I mean, I appreciate. I'm really honored to be here. Thank you. it's about art, but I'm sorry, I don't consider myself as an artist. I consider myself as a messenger, as a photojournalist, and I think it's very important. I take my work very seriously. I'm very dedicated.
Yes, but on a symbolical level, I mean, there are references. We all have references,
well,
human references, not necessarily artistic ones, human references. And these figures that you manage to put on your photo, these expressions, reminds us something almost religious, on one hand, and something very heroic and symbolic on the other. Let's see the photo that I called Hero, with the father. This is one of the most amazing photos.
Thank you. Yeah, well, it's easy for me to say it's my favorite photo because I would love to be that father. I think every father would want to be this father. And I received a lot of emails and phone calls and people on the street who said, well, thank you for illustrating the perfect father. And I said, well, it's not only that, but I think with this photo I proved that they are superheroes after all. I always make this joke because this guy, look at him. He wears, it's not the Superman's red cape, but it's a garbage. It's a cape made by garbage plastic, material. But, you know, he's carrying his daughter for miles and miles through the bad weather on September 10 up in the border. And it's that moment where it's unconditional love. It's the father to the daughter. And my daughter, I have an 11-year-old daughter, and she said, that could be me and you, Dad. I said, well, let's hope we're not going to have a situation where we have to become refugees, but you never know. So we have to, you know, remember this. And it's my favorite photo.
Let's finish with this message of hope. And you can ask some questions if you have to Yannis Behrakis. There are two micros that are in the room. Yes. Just speak when you have the micro on your hand. Thank you.
Hello. This is more a question about humanity, but then again, your work is all about humanity. The Greek public was praised a lot in the Western media, particularly the German media, about the way they reacted and helped out in this situation. I guess this is more of a philosophical question, but have you experienced something like that? And why is it that in situations like this, people that have the least are the people that actually give the most? Did you experience that generosity about the Greek public that was all around the media?
Yeah, well, you know, I'm fortunate. I'm very fortunate to do this job for over the years. And I've been witnessing, generosity and, you know, the opposite for over 30 years, as I said earlier. And, in situations like this, you see who is who and who has what inside in times of crisis. And in this particular moment, as I said, in this situation, I was very anxious because it's my own country. And, I feel uncomfortable when people would say, oh, you know, the Greeks, they didn't do well and all this. So I've been watching and I'm very critical. And I've seen a lot of people helping, and especially imagine Greece is a country in crisis for over 6 years. So people, they suffer. They don't have, it's over 25% unemployment, and it's terrible. So in the middle of the crisis like this, another crisis, a global crisis, arrives in Greece, and that was the ultimate test. And I think Greeks did well. Of course, there were situations where people were against the flow of refugees and all these things. But I've seen some amazing situations where people who had nothing, really, they shared their little nothing. There were women who were coming down on the beach in Lesbos, local women, to cook nice, you know, handmade food for the refugees, for people that would never, they never knew, and they would never see in their lives again, and they would bring in clothes and all this. So, yeah, you know, it was a very sad situation, and it was a humanistic crisis, but also it proved, this situation proved that humanity is alive. And as I said, a lot of people came, and I remember going there, and friends from the building I live in Athens would say, "Oh, are you going to Lesbos again?" I said, "Yeah." "Take these clothes with you." I said, "Hey, I can't take everything." So a lot of times, at some point, I stopped going by plane, and I would take my car and fill it up with clothes and presents from friends in the neighborhood to donate to the coming refugees in their name. And it was funny how I was trying to, this is from Mr. Costas, lives in the first floor and all this, because I want to give credit. But also it was great for these people to feel that, okay, we escaped from, and now we are in a place where people, you know, give us some help. So yeah, it was great to witness the humanity.
Another question. Yes, please.
For them.
Hi. Amazing work, Yannis. Thank you. I'm Roger Cohen from the New York Times.
Hi.
I was on Lesbos and I witnessed that generosity you've just described. What comes through in your photographs, to me more than anything, is the individual humanity of each refugee. Each refugee is an individual with his or her life. But people like President Trump, with his new America First outlook, portrays refugees as an undifferentiated mob bringing danger. And that, of course, is also taken hold to quite considerable degree in Europe. Britain has chosen to make its future outside the European Union. There's a very important French election next month. So how do you explain that this individual humanity that you portray so powerfully gets lost, and the ascendant movement at the moment, political movement, is a nationalist, populist movement portraying all these people as danger?
Okay, well, that's a tough question. you know, as a, you know, as a Reuters journalist, I don't want to get into politics, but
go on, try.
don't do this. Later. But no, I mean, you know, my message is simple. Obviously, they're not dangerous. Yeah, I'm sure there are bad people. You know, I'm sure everywhere you go, you find, you know, the good people, the bad people, the dangerous people there. What I know is that if we look inside us, including the president, he has some either refugee or migrant blood. So it's something, you know, we people tend to forget. We forget our roots, we forget our voyage through life. You know, I always say, you never know what I said before, you never know. One day you find yourself, if you're not careful, you find yourself in one of my pictures. Believe me, you don't want to do this. And how you stop this? By, you know, taking a step back, thinking twice. I use this expression, think twice before you pull the trigger. You know, we all live in a in a very small, as it turned out, planet. And I think, you know, from here to back home is less than 4 hours. What I'm trying to say is the message is simple. And sometimes we forget the very, very simple things, that we are all made by the same material and we all live under the same sky and we all drink out of, you know, more or less the same water and you know, we have our issues and we have our struggle for life and, you know, these people just happen to be a little bit unlucky at this point. And, you know, if we look back into ourselves, maybe it's a little bit of our mistake, you know, their drama. We are somehow co-responsible. And this is what I want to do with my pictures. I'm trying to avoid you. to enter the living rooms and the houses of, you know, a global audience and give my message and say, look, you know, this guy needs your help. Or look at this situation. For me, it's important, you know, as journalists, to tell the world what's going on and make you feel lucky that, you know, you're not in this situation. Now, what you do after you see the picture or read the story, that's up to you. But my job is to make sure that nobody in the world can say, I didn't know. That's my answer. Thank you.
As we all understand, humanity for Yannis Behrakis has no boundaries. And I would like to thank you, Yannis, for being here with us. Now let's welcome Farah Nayeri in conversation with an artist without boundaries, the great Bob Wilson.
Thank you.